The Ministry of Secondary Education has developed a distance learning platform for students of secondary education in Cameroon. A series of lessons taught by qualified teachers for secondary school students. Under the stewardship of Professor Pauline Nalovalyonga, in collaboration with the Ministry of Posts and Telecommunications, CAMTEL, CRTV, and UNESCO, we are introducing distance learning as another teaching and learning method which is different from the traditional classroom setting that you are all used to. In the distance education mode, you are not with the teacher in person, so take your time, relax, listen to the teacher, take down notes and visit the following links for any questions or answers to your questions. Take it in your stride. This is Cameroon's solution to COVID-19 and beyond. Professor Nalovalyonga, Minister of Secondary Education.
Welcome to lesson 47 of your distance learning session for Geology of Basic Science with Kenneth Yosumbo. During our lesson 46, we have some assignments to do. We shall now proceed by correcting the assignment. Number one, outline the changes occurring when true graptolites separated from the dendroid graptolites. Number two, discuss graptolites as environmental indicators. Now, the approach to this question requires that we should focus attention on the changes occurring when the graptolites separated from the dendroid graptolites. The whole picture has to do with the evolution of fossil graptolites. In the first approach, the true graptolites were lesser and they have a small theca. The small theca is also referred to as the bitheca. They also were lesser and they generally have lesser crossbars, which is also referred to as the discipline. The discipline was it for late forms are always between the spikes. True graptolites lack internal stolon. It means they lack also the stolon taker. The AD graptolites, that is the dendroids, had many spikes. Early forms have many similar taker, as well as they were mostly pendant. The reclined forms disappeared at the end of Ordovician, leaving only the standard form, which were Bicera. And they ended up, or they came to extinction during the Silurian. That is the guide to the approach of explaining the evolutionary changes that operated between the early form graptolites, that is the dendroids, and the true graptolites. Second part of our question, graptolites as environmental indicators. In this question, attention is focused on how those evolutionary changes happen and the significance they brought about in the fossil graptolite. The evolutionary changes indicate deep, quiet, and anaerobic environments. Those are environments where the oxygenation is on the rise. Their appearance ensures is assurance of very deep and quiet waters. Here, it may even go beyond the abyssal plain That is, at the harder zone, at depths of above 6,000 meters. Medium forms rich in organic matter give that color of shell. So, graptolites indicate the color nature of shell, not necessarily the cementing material as it is often known for sedimentary rocks because of the environment of formation. The evolutionary changes in graptolites also indicate reducing environments with the presence of pyrite being deposited. This was the approach of the question. Our topic of discussion remains paleontology. Before we've seen the scope of paleontology, I've seen types of fossils, conditions necessary for fossilization, modes of fossilization, occurrence and uses of fossils, gaps in fossil records, as well as fossil assemblages. We've also seen classification of fossils. These topics helps us, therefore, to concentrate on describing fossils, which is our topic of discussion for today. So, our lesson 47 is titled Description of Fossils 14. We will focus on Phylum Coelenterata. Under our lesson today, we'll look at the objectives, shall also find out information that is essential to grasp the topic and well, that is the prerequisites. Look at the real life situation, come up with some hypotheses. We'll look at the lesson or the learning activity. We'll have recall, we'll have some exercises, and we shall end our lesson with an assignment. The lesson objective. We will, at the end of our lesson, be able to describe and identify fossil genera under Phylum Coelenterata based on shell form. We underline shell form, meaning morphological features and those ecological aspects of the shell will be very essential. Before, we have learned on geological basis for classifying fossils. Well, we saw that fossils in geology are most likely classified based on morphological and ecological aspects, where it will help us to place them under a particular phylum, give them or identify them under a particular class, as well as identify them to have lived in a particular pattern of life. We have also been able to group fossils into their different phyla. Now, a petroleum engineer visits the Bakassi Peninsula in southwest Cameroon. He collected samples of the rocks in different localities and noted many types of fossil shells, as well as fossil traces. He also realized that for the fossil shells as well as the fossil traces, they differ greatly. Now, the question is, what revealed the differences between the fossils? That is, the fossil shells and the fossil traces. As hypothesis, could it be that it is the effect of denudational agents on the fossils? Could that be what revealed those differences? Could it be the idea of gaps in fossil records? Maybe it would have been the element of morphological and ecological aspects of the fossils. As we go through our lesson, we shall, at the end, be able to identify which of the hypotheses is correct. That is, should have helped the petroleum engineer to discover the differences in the fossil shells as well as the fossil traces. Now, for our lesson today, shall take a look at these fossil shells, that is from A, B, C, D, E, and F. While you observe them, you shall deduce the visible features. As you observe also, you should be able to identify those features that are diagnostic in all the photos that are provided. That is from photo A to photo F. Now notice the central position, the placement for both fossil A to fossil B, it is hidden. But the outer shell indicates some folding. For fossil A, C, and E, the top portion is very clear. So, the diagnostic features that are identical in the different photos involve the tube, that is, the top portion that looks rounded, called the corallite. We have the vertical radial partitioning, that is very common with fossil B, D, and F. That is generally called the septa. Then we have the upper end skeleton, which is visible for fossil A, C, and E. This is called, or this provides the cup-shaped structure that is called the calyx. These are the visible features that are diagnostic in the photos we have just seen. So this guides us to our topic of discussion, the phylum Selenterata. Generally, this particular phylum or the fossil that fall under this phylum have a skeleton with series of vertical folds called mesenteries. There is vertical partitioning like we saw, and this vertical partitioning refers to the septa. That is the plural. In the singular is septum. They also have a vertical calcareous rod that is referred to as the columella. That is the vertical calcareous rod called the columella. The septa is joined by the cipament. Remember that the cipament are crossbars. They appear or they work out the shell to be stable. They also have a series of horizontal plates referred to as tabula. Now the classification of fossils under the phylum Selenterata. We will have the class, the subclasses, as well as the order. The common classes under this phylum involve Hydrozoa, then Cyzozoa, Cyphozoa, then the Anthozoa. We have some classes like the Octaforella, then we have the Zontoria. Then the common order here includes other Tabulata, other Rugosa, then other Sclerotina. Most fossils under this phylum are common with the class Anthozoa, generally referred to as corals. Corals are the only selenterates of paleontological significance. Other classes would have been fossilized, but this one in particular is of paleontological significance. There are three others common under the class Anthozoa. We have the order Rugosa, which ranges from Cambrian to Triassic. We have the order Tabulata, which ranges from Cambrian to Permian. Then the order Sclerotina, which ranges from Triassic to Permian. Remember that this is a reflection of the stratigraphic column. Here, the whole structure is centered on the aeon phanerozoic. This is the shell morphology of rugosa. That is A, is for rugosa. Then B for tabulata. You see the whole structure occurs in form of columns. Then C for scleractina. What is peculiar in both is the presence of the calyx in all the three cases. That is a morphological feature that can be used to identify the fossils under this particular class, Anthozoa. So corals are known for the presence of this particular part, the calyx. We take the first order, order rugosa. Order rugosa is generally called rugose corals. They are solid or compound, and they are most likely placed as phanerozoic fossils. Generally have a calcareous skeleton, meaning that they are preserved by calcium carbonate. They have a vertical radial partitioning, and so they have the presence of a septa. Remember, we said septa is the plural and septum the singular. They are bilateral symmetry, they have a bilateral symmetry. And the septa is arranged in four local forms only. That is very peculiar. The arrangement of the septa in four local forms. They have a horn-shaped structure, especially with the solitary forms. Then, the cup-shaped structure is called the calyx. Remember that it is the main diagnostic feature. Then, the small convex plate, which forms the recipient or crossbars. Then we have the transverse element or the tabula. They are also characterized by a corallite, especially in the compound rugose corals. They have a free corallite, and this forms the, this is very common with the fasciculate, or is a part generally referred to as the fasciculate. Then the corallite is touching each other, and it makes the whole structure look massive. That differentiates it again from the other that fall under the class Anthozoa. This is the shell form that is generally presented by rugose corals. So in the shell form, you have the septum. We say that when there are many of them, we call them septa. You have the septum, you have the fossula. Fossula is this structure. Then we have group lines, or you call them group rings. And you have the septal furrow. That is between the group lines. Then we have the calyx, then the septum. We have the recipient, which are crossbars. Then we have the tabula, the septum again, then group lines, then the epitheca. Remember, that is a smaller theca. Then we have the epicarp end. This is the drawing position. Note must be taken that in order to read and to be able to identify the morphological features, there is need to follow the drawing position for each of the fossil form in order to maintain the morphological features. Description of fasciculate corallium. The dendron. Like we said, this structure is partitioned into four. We have the dendroid, that is the further fasciculate corallium. Then the fascicoid, which is the irregular branching corallite. Then we have the celoid, which is a massive corallite. That is, by virtue of the fact that it's massive, it makes them appear in polygonal shapes. Then the astracoid. The astracoid is massive with no corallite walls. These are elements and aspects that could be used to differentiate the corals from other forms, or the robust corals from other forms. Description of the fascicoid corallium. This is the case for the dendroid, the ceroid, the fascinoid, and the cylindrical. The shell presentation is very important. Then the calyx. The calyx in robust corals is small and is deep, and it presents a deep depression. The center of depression forms the axial region, and the calyx is closed by the operculum. The septum projects from the floor of the calyx. Therefore, it is a structure that defines how other structures are built up. That is why it is a key diagnostic part to use to class fossils under this other mucosa. That is the calyx and the corallium view. This is the calyx. You see the septus radiate from there, the corallium wall, and then the ectoderm and the endoderm. This is the whole structure. The sixth primary septa. Here we have the cardinal, level C, the counter, level K, then the two outer A, and then two counter lateral CL, as you can see represented in this structure. It has been isolated and drawn in different parts to represent the six calyx. So that is the septal insertion in robust corals. Very important. Now the shell form of robust corals. Look at this photo. You realize that in their shell form, the septa and the coralline are essential diagnostic features, especially for the compound forms. So shell form and mode of life. We have the first example, the lithostrosium. It has a compound form and the fascicoid skeleton. They also are massive, or maybe ceroid, as you can see in their structures. Ceroid simply means a circular appearance. Then they have radially arranged septa, and they have disfigurement and tabula. There is also this different aspects or parts help them to be shallow, as well as warm water dwellers. Their age is lower Carboniferous. That is the diagrammatic representation in the drawing position or in the reading position. You see the disfigurement, the major septum, the minor septum, and the columella. Then the second example, we have the dibonophyllum. Here it has a cylindrical shaped corallite, and there are numerous major septa. Then it takes the shape of a spider web, especially in the axial region. Also, it has a concentric and a radial appearance. And the horn shape. Also, this structure, the fact that it has a concentric and a radial shape, makes them shallow water dwellers, and they are aged Carboniferous. Now recall that Coelenterates are characterized by skeleton with series of vertical folds. They also have a scepter, a columella, discipliment, as well as the tabula. Corals are sedentaries of paleontological significance with three others, namely, we have the order Rugosa, which ranged from Cambrian to Triassic, the order Tabulata, which ranged from Cambrian to Permian, then the order Ceratina, which ranges from Triassic to Permian. You could say it is Triassic Permian. Now we shall look at some exercises. Our first exercise targets our real life situation that we evoke at the beginning of the lesson. At the beginning, we were wondering what the petroleum engineer who visited the Bakassi Peninsula would have used to differentiate the fossil traces and the fossil shells. So, exercise number one, what revealed the differences between the fossils observed by the petroleum engineer in the Bakassi Peninsula? A. The effect of the invasional agents on the fossils. B. The idea of gaps in fossil records. C. Morphological and ecological aspects of the fossils. Throughout our lesson, we learned that to be able to identify an organism or make a difference, we are supposed to use morphological features. That is why we kept talking of the shell form. So our correct answer is C, morphological and ecological aspects of the fossils would have helped our petroleum engineer to differentiate the different fossil shells as well as the fossil traces. Match the six primary septa skeleton in Rogo's orals. You have in the table, you have abbreviation, and you have the septum. A, C, CL, and K. Remember that in the course of our lesson, we indicated what those particular abbreviations signify. Then for the septum, you have arta, you have the canta, you have the cardinal, and you have the canta latera. So A is for arta, C for canta, CL for cardinal, and K for canta latera. Number three, identify the fossil genera and features level A to D and W in the structures that are provided. You have A, you have B, you have C, and you have D. Then there is this feature that is common with A, B, and C. So A is dendroid coralli. Then B, phasmoid coralli. C, cylindrical coralli. And then D, ceroid coralli. Then that part, W, is for the calyx. Now, after having gone through our lesson, it is important that we take some work to do at home. So while at home, you shall draw and label the following morphological variations found in Rogo's corals, and you will give an example of each. The first one, we have dendroid corallum. Then B, phasmoid corallum. You shall do that at home. You can also read texts like Geology for Advanced Level, Fundamentals of Geology, and the Principles of Geology. They will help you to do the work at home. We have come to the end of our lesson. Our next lesson will be on Description of Fossils 15, where we shall still concentrate on Phylum Celenterata. This time we will handle the other Tabulata and Sclerotina. See you in our next lesson.
Unatege si matege yop, unatege minga matege nyum, unatege majang matege ndom, manetambia ninya ne njubyayen, ngani bana matege mot, ngani lakiri watege ndong, esekina bia dinkido, manetambia ninya ne njubyayen, tamtama mote tamzabike, Tam tama tonge tam zabike tam tam tama mote tam zabike mane tambia ninyane njubyayen.